So I'm Richard Graham. I look after the International Grants Programme of Comic Relief. And when Dermot kind of said, come talk and it's a pretty free brief, I kind of thought, what should I talk about? And I kind of thought, well, look, I've been doing this business for 30 years. So I just thought, well, I'll kind of reflect on the last 30 years and try and talk a bit about how you actually create social change in international development. And I'm focusing primarily on Sub-Saharan Africa because that's where I've done most of my work over the years. And I'm going to focus on kind of three things, which I think are the three kind of core elements that are key to generating social change, and they are kind of people, organisations, and ideas. So throughout this whole presentation, I'll be talking and referring to those three things. And this very much kind of represents my own kind of personal journey, if you will, that I've been through over the last 30 years in understanding international development. And it starts here, because back in 1980, it didn't actually start in the Hacienda, it wasn't actually a conversation there, but I was a mostly university student when the Hacienda opened, and was studying social anthropology there somewhere. I bumped into a fellow social anthropology PhD student who sort of said, what are you doing when you graduate? And I went, and she said, well, do you want to come and work with me? And I said, what do you do? And she said, I want to work in Egypt with some nomads in the desert. And I thought, well, that sounds all right, I'll do that then. So that's what I did. And so this is one of the first leaders I'm going to talk about. Her name is Shahira Fawzi. She was a fantastically interesting individual. She was came from a very kind of wealthy Egyptian family in Cairo. They owned loads of land. She was very into kind of the latest Paris fashion. She looked really kind of fantastic all the time. She smoked like a chimney. She drove a car. She was very kind of outspoken, which in itself is kind of fine, but when you locate that person in Upper Egypt, which is a very, very conservative part of Egypt, and you've got this smoking, driving, single woman who has no concern about speaking her mind to men or women, she was a pretty controversial figure. She had some really good leadership qualities. She was visionary. She absolutely knew what she wanted to achieve for the nomadic communities in the desert. She was absolutely dogged about going for it. However, she was also a terrible manager, and she was very poor at kind of relationship management, very ineffective at building with relationships both within the organization that she led and beyond, and that was sort of key to why the program ultimately failed, which I should come on to. So the organization was called SEPCAD, and I have no idea what it stands for. I probably knew once. NGOs are really good at creating acronyms that once created, you have no idea what it stands for. So the issue here was the Egyptian government built the High Dam at Aswan. When they built it, all the guys who were living on the Nile got relocated into a nice new place. Actually, it wasn't very nice. And all the people, all the nomads who were not there at the time because they were out in the Red Sea hills looking after their animals, they came over to the Nile for the summer pastures. Nothing there, just water. So they were really badly displaced by the complete loss of their livelihood, by having lost their summer pastures, which they had been doing since pre-Pharaonic times. There were issues of cultural identity and stigmatization. You know, the Beja were a distinct ethnic group in Egypt. They spoke Tobajawi, didn't speak English or Arabic. And a very, very strong kind of identity as nomadic pastoralists, and highly stigmatized. And a bit like how Europeans would perceive Roma gypsies. You know, they eat your children and they kind of do terrible things. So they had a really tough time with the Egyptian government. There were no services, no health services, education services or anything else. And they had no identification, they had no ID card. So they were sort of not citizens, although they lived in Egypt and had lived there way before everybody else. And as again, you can see the picture quite a long way from decision makers and power. So this was the issues that we were wrestling with. And so what we were trying to do on the project is to create sustainable livelihoods for these displaced communities and to try and get services to them, which was about working with the Egyptian government to say, look, these guys need basic health, education and other services. We made some small progress on that, and the livelihoods was working quite well, but it was kind of complicated because most of their money was coming from smuggling stuff between the Egyptian and the Sudanese border. So the livelihood strategy was based on smuggling, which kind of put us in a slightly awkward position. Now, the reason for telling you about this project was, for me, it was a great example of what these guys, Mason and Mitrov, call messy problems. I don't know if you've come across the concept, but I'm a great fan of messy problems. And the reason I tell the story of the project in Egypt was it was a classic messy problem. There was interconnectedness, complicated uncertainty, ambiguity, conflicts, societal constraints. All those things I've just talked to you about the program, about the Beja Nomads, absolutely brilliant messy problem. So what Mason and Mitrov says is if you have messy problems, the kind of responses you need to identify diverse sources of information to really understand the problem, really unpack it as best you can, map out all the players, build effective relationships with all the relevant people who you think might be able to make a useful contribution to sorting out the messy problem, and recognizing there is no single answer. Which is why I had at the beginning of the title, Beware Geeks Bearing Gifts, because the geeks who kind of go, oh, I've got a silver bullet, I can solve all your problems. Not really. Not with messy problems. There are always going to be multiple answers. Let me give you another example. Think about bed nets, right? People will get malaria, stick a bed net over them, problem solved. Well, we were funding another organization called the Malaria Consortium, a very good organization, who were doing a bed net distribution. So you'd think, you know, buy the bed nets, give it to the people, job done. But even if you're looking at just prevention, there's a lot of evidence out there that says if you do really good community education on bed net provision, how you hang it up, making sure that the most vulnerable members of the household sleep under the bed net, that they're under the net at the right time, and so on, that needs work, because otherwise communities might use it as fishing nets, bridal veils, or whatever else they choose to use bed nets for. But if you actually want to reduce the incidence of preventable malaria in a community, simply doing some basic prevention work is not going to solve your problem. What you need to do is you need to work with communities that they seek treatment at the appropriate time. So when a kid has a fever, they don't go to the local kind of witch doctor, or they don't go to the local pharmacist who just sells various kind of out-of-date drugs. They actually go to a health facility that can then do a correct diagnosis. So they need diagnostic tools to make sure that the fever is caused by malaria and not by something else. Staff need to be trained in doing correct diagnosis. You need the right drugs to provide people, and they need to be available, because very often you get big stockouts in health facilities. And you need a functioning referral system, so if that kid is, you know, fitting or in a really bad state, then you need to refer them to the district hospital. So suddenly what looked like a simple linear problem of bed nets over here, distribute them over there, job done, suddenly becomes quite a messy problem, because you're dealing with the system of a health service and behaviours and attitudes and values of communities, which are not always what you want them to be. Which comes to this next idea I wanted to kind of play with. Slinkies are lots of fun. I do a lot with my kids. But the interesting thing, you know, if you've got a slinky in your house, I meant to bring one actually, I forgot. You know, when you've got a slinky in your hand, you do that. And the point that this woman, Donella Menos, who's the kind of guru on systems thinking, the reason she uses the slinky analogy is that the behavior of the slinky is defined by the nature of what it is. So she says a system is a set of things interconnected in such a way they produce their own patterns of behavior over time. Now what that means, if you take a health system, for example, the way a health system responds to an issue like malaria will be defined by the nature of the health system and how that system operates. And I think that's very important when you're starting to think about systems, like how you change a health system. Because if you don't know how the interconnectedness and the behaviours within a system operate, you're not going to change it effectively. And she talks about a system having three key components: the elements, the interconnections, and the purpose. So a health system's purpose is to make sure people don't get sick or they get treated. The interconnections are what happens from the very point that people start using a health service all the way up to the kind of policy framework at a national level. And the elements are all the different parts of the health service within it, whether it's about distributing drugs or diagnostics or whatever it might be. So I want to talk about a program we funded a while back, which I thought was exceptional in their systems thinking. And they, to return to my thing about people and leadership, the reason there are no pictures of actual people there is not just because I couldn't find the pictures on the internet, which was also a problem, but the fact that I couldn't find their pictures on the internet was actually significant. Because there's something about Conrad and Graham and Don and Haroon, which is a different type of leadership to, say, Shahira. Shahira was out there, she was larger than life, she was a character, she was charismatic, she was annoying, she was all sorts of things. These guys were sort of, had a very different leadership style. They were sort of invisible. They had offices somewhere in the Ministry of Health in Tanzania, which is, they were working on a health system. They were very smart guys, but they had no big personality. They were, you know, I don't know if you know all the kind of Myers-Briggs types, but they were a kind of INFG, I think it is. They were kind of the quiet introverted types, but very sharp and very, very smart. And the reason I want to kind of just relate them into this story is that recognition that leadership can take very, very different forms. It isn't your kind of classic Richard Branson style of leadership. These guys played a brilliant leadership style, but the way I kind of often define them or describe them is they were sort of like a benevolent virus within the Tanzanian health system. They operated within the system almost sort of invisibly, but were incredibly effective at changing the system. So the project they worked for was called THIP, which again stands for something, God knows what, probably Tanzania something. Anyway, where it started with this. The World Bank produced a paper years back which said if we spend an extra dollar per person per year in health, we will get disproportionately high reductions in child and adult mortality. So Conrad and Don and these guys went, okay, well, let's give it a go. Let's give three districts an extra pound per person per year and see what happens. So they gave these three districts however much cash it was. And about a year later, they sort of came back to the district and sort of went, well, how's it gone? What does the data look like? And the district had spent about 16 cents per person per year. And they were like, give you a dollar, come on. And the guys just at the district medical officer just went, I don't want to spend it on. So the THIP team went, well, what's the burden of disease here in Rufiji district? And the guy went, I don't know. I mean, I've got data of what the disease is of people coming into health facilities, but that represents a tiny proportion of people with diseases and deaths. And he has no data on deaths in his district, because 80% of people in Tanzania will die in the home, they won't die in the health facility. So any death mortality data you have in a health facility is sort of useless. So they went, okay, fine, that's not a problem. So they did this analysis of mortality and morbidity in the district, used this very cool tool called a verbal autopsy. So they basically went into households and did this brilliant questionnaire, which actually helped them figure out what people were dying of or had died of. And they got some really good data. And they came back to the district health officer and said, right, we've got the data on the burden of disease in your district. It's this. And the guys look at it and they went, whoa. And then they looked at their budget and they went, does our budget correlate with the burden of disease in the district? Nope. No way. Way off beam. So the guys went, okay, well, the first thing we could do is just realign the budget to the burden of disease. You know, kind of obvious, but nobody had really thought of it. So that's what they did. So that's the first thing. They also realised the way management worked in the health service in Tanzania was not great. Every single decision came up to the district medical officer. So the THIP team were kind of going, this is nuts. So they built these satellite management teams within the larger health clinics within the district, and then they kind of made decisions and budget allocations, a whole bunch of other stuff. And so the district medical officer had a bit more time to kind of think more strategically. They had a terrible communication system, so they started, I mean, this was pre-mobile phones, so they started using things like radio in order to make sure they got the drugs on time or the referrals worked properly. And they realized that they needed to engage the community. The community wanted, they had to get the community to want the health service, and they wanted the community to trust the health service. So they did all this stuff. And 3 or 4 years later, they got adult mortality down by 18%, child mortality down by 40%. I mean, it was stunning. But what they were doing is that they were working absolutely, this benevolent virus within the health system, of working with all the different components of that system and kind of going, how can we make this work a bit better? How can we make that work a bit better? And working with the district health teams and working with the chief medical officer and working with all the people that they felt were the most influential within the system. So at this point, the Minister of Health, who had got all this data, went, whoa, I want more, I want this everywhere. So they went, fine, we'll do a national rollout. So they've done it in three districts, they're like 127 districts or something in Tanzania. So what, national rollout through these seven, they just created these seven new health zonal training centers. So great, we'll roll it out through there. Unfortunately, around that time, the Minister of Health leaves, Chief Medical Officer leaves, and the Permanent Secretary, all of whom the TGIP team built really good relationships with. That was a real bummer. Because actually the rollout never really happened. Because they just hit the buffers, because they had lost the people at senior levels within the ministry who could really be the champions of this methodology and this approach. And that comes to my next idea about black swans. You know that thing about when you say, if you've seen 100 white swans, you cannot say there are no black swans. You can just say that there are 100 white swans. This is where that whole theory comes from. And it's this guy called Nassim Taleb wrote the book called The Black Swan. And as you say, it's a metaphor that describes an event that comes as a surprise, has a major effect, often inappropriately rationalized after the fact with the benefit of hindsight. Now he came to the whole black swan theory from looking at the way in which markets behaved. So when, you know, you've got a bull market and everybody's investing and it's just going to keep going up and up and up and up, and then crash, black swan. And he's sitting there kind of going, hang on, the stock markets do that the whole time. Why does everybody think that it's just going to keep going up this time? Why does nobody think that it's going to crash sooner or later? It's nuts. But then he got so interested in this idea that he went beyond the world of markets and finance and started looking in other areas of work and just went, this happens everywhere. People sort of work on a slightly linear model. And if things are going in a particular direction, people start assuming that they're going to carry on going in that direction for the foreseeable future. And of course it never happens. And I think that was true to some degree with the THIP team, is they thought their relationships, the work that they were doing, would lead to this national rollout because they got it all sorted. And it didn't. Now, I'm not saying that you can predict every unexpected eventuality. Of course you can't. But I think what we're not always good at is that we're not always good at thinking about what the black swans might be and what mitigation strategies we might employ to manage them as well as we might. And that comes to kind of my next idea, which is about adaptation. And there's a great book by a guy called Tim Harford, who wrote The Undercover Economist. I don't know if you've come across it. But he's a great writer, and his book Adapt is fantastic. And he writes, the world has become far too unpredictable and profoundly complex. We must adapt, improvise rather than plan, work from the bottom up than the top down, baby steps rather than great leaps forward. And this is kind of central, I think, to, I guess, what I've kind of feel I've learned over the years, is it is all about adaptation. It's all about tweaking and realigning rather than the big old ambitious plan. And for those of us who've had the joy of completing logical frameworks, do people know what logical frameworks are? Okay, well, big funders like the European Union Department for International Development, require you to complete this logical framework. And basically the way a logical framework works is it says, these are your inputs, these are your activities, these are your these are the outputs you will create, which will lead to these outcomes and then lead to this impact. And while there's nothing wrong with a log frame, it's a basic, simple planning tool. To assume that social change will occur in a linear, predictable way is kind of nonsense. And I have to say, there's a slight kind of conspiracy, I think, that goes on, a conspiracy of silence or a conspiracy of something that goes on between NGOs who get funding from the people like DFID and the European Union and the funders, that we all sort of think it's going to happen in this linear, predictable way. And it never does. It never does. So I feel this whole notion of adaptation, of constantly reflecting on your practice and changing your practice accordingly, is absolutely fundamental, and it's just not sufficiently there within, in my view, within the NGO DNA, and I think it needs to be more. Right. Mulugeta Gebru, top guy. He's another leader who I wanted to talk about. Ethiopian. He came to this organisation called JECDO, which again stands for something. And at the time it ran orphanages for vulnerable kids in Ethiopia. And he arrived and he went, well, this is a bit crap. And we shouldn't be having institutional care. It's not in the best interest of the child. We should move to community-based care. And it's also, you know, an awful lot cheaper as well. So he was kind of very visionary in the way that he brought about a dramatic change in the whole model of how JECDO worked with orphan and vulnerable children. He's an incredibly charming, he is more of the charming, charismatic type of leader. We had Tony Blair, who wanted to go and visit a Comrade project, and we thought, well, who better than Mulugeta? And he was just brilliant with Blair. And then we had Brad Pitt, who wanted to come and visit a project, so we went, let's take him to Mulugeta. Mulugeta charmed the pants off Brad Pitt. Brad Pitt thought the guy was absolutely God. You know, it's brilliant. So he's got that. He's such a brilliant relationship builder with people, whoever they are, and he's completely unfazed. Brad Pitt, Blair, yeah, whatever, you know. He will do everybody. And at the same time, you will see him in the community with, say, a woman who's looking after some extra orphan kids, and he is exactly the same with her as he is with Brad Pitt. I mean, he's that sort of guy. He's just terrific. So the organisation that he runs, JECDO, the thing I wanted to focus on was his approach to adaptation, and this was particularly in relationship to adaptation within a much constrained political environment in Ethiopia. So some years back, the Ethiopian government, for a bunch of reasons I won't go into, decided that NGOs were, you know, a threat to the regime. So they cracked down on externally funded NGOs. So they basically said, if you as an Ethiopian NGO get more than 10% of your income from an international source, you are not allowed to do advocacy work at all in this country. They didn't like kind of human rights organizations kind of giving them a hard time. So the political space for advocacy was deeply constrained. Now at that time, JECDO was a big international, or big Ethiopian NGO, a lot of funding from Common Relief and elsewhere. So Mulugeta was like, how do I deal with this one? And what he did, he basically Jekto the NGO, just sort of slowly, quietly, almost disappeared. And what he did in its place is he set up lots and lots and lots and lots of community-based organisations in the different urban areas in which he was working. Because community-based organisations are registered differently from an international NGO or from an Ethiopian NGO and are entitled to do lobbying with national government. And I thought this was a really smart way of adapting to a situation, because you go and visit the CBOs in Diridawa or Addis or wherever it might be. These were smart people in the community who were going to the Warado or going to the Kabeli, which are the kind of government offices, and kind of going, look, the water pumps are broken, or there are no drugs in the clinic, or whatever it was that was their issue. They were out there holding the government to account to provide the kind of services that they were required to do. And I just thought he was very, very smart in how he engineered that whole adaptation. And the organisation it transformed itself. He also, with some investment from Comet Relief, thought, well, I need to generate my own income. I can't rely on Comet Relief or external funders in the foreseeable future, because this is not going to change anytime soon. So he built some training institutes and started generating significant income by running accredited training courses for Ethiopians. And as I say, he invested very heavily in the community organisations to help them do their advocacy work as effectively as possible. So he was great at many things, like all of us. He has his Achilles heel. Like a lot of kind of social entrepreneurs you meet, they're kind of visionary, they're forward thinking, they've got it, they're doing their thing. They're not that interested in sort of monitoring and evaluation and data. And he wasn't so great at all that kind of stuff. and this is where I'm going to kind of bring in another idea, which I think is kind of seminal, is the learning organisation, which came from this book Peter Senge, who wrote The Fifth Discipline. And he kind of characterises the learning organisation in these five ways. Systems thinking, we've already talked about, it's the slinky, it's seeing the whole interconnections. Personal mastery, I don't know if you've come across that notion that to achieve personal mastery, you have to do 10,000 hours. I don't know how many years 10,000 hours is, but I'm sure I've worked 30 years in this business, I ought to have some bloody personal mastery. But that's the notion of personal mastery. He kind of feels that if you are going to become really effective and really effective in a learning organisation, is you have to have done your 10,000 hours. That's what personal mastery is about. And the third thing was mental models. And this was fascinating, because he was sort of saying, look, we have mental models of how we think social change takes place, and often we have to unlearn them because they're wrong. And he talks about, I don't know if you've come across this phrase called double loop learning, i.e. you create a sort of project that you think will create change for, say, young people. Instead of just kind of going, well, how do we adapt what we're doing to make it slightly better, you might want to go back and go, actually, were the underlying assumptions that created this kind of project framework that we generated actually wrong in the first instance? Do we need to kind of challenge our own fundamental assumptions? And I think that's what Senge was really into in mental models. He was saying, always be willing to challenge some of your underlying assumptions about how you think change takes place, because it may not be right. And then the shared vision and the team learning were very critical for, particularly for the organization. If you want a really efficient learning organization, you've all got to be heading in the same direction. You've all got to kind of really know where you're trying to get to. And you want to do it together as a team. And he was talking about team-based learning, where you are constantly reflecting on your own practice. There's a great expression by a guy called Donald Shon called the reflective practitioner. Shon was very much talking about people that learn on the job. Both he and Senge were kind of going, going off on your kind of training course for this or your training course for that, sort of fine, but actually where you really learn is on the job, every single day, new information coming in, new ways of thinking, new contacts. That's where the learning takes place. So another leader I want to talk about, who I think she has taken on board a lot of this learning organisation approach, is a woman called Atuki Turner. I met her years ago when she was working at a women's refuge in Bristol. Really nice woman, quite quiet, unassuming. And she was a Ugandan, well, she said this is Ugandan. And she was sort of doing the classic, you know, diaspora thing, sending money home to your family, you know, pays for your grandmother to get some, you know, treatment in the hospital or whatever. And she was kind of going, well, that's sort of fine, but it's not kind of changing anything. You know, I go back to my community, it's still as poor as it was when I was there last year. So then she started trying to get some money together for building a school or a clinic. And she came to Common Relief and we said, we don't really do school building and stuff, that's for governments to do. And she came back and said, what about kind of like an income generating program for women, you know, for, you know, women earning an independent income? And we said, oh, that's, you know, we've got a dedicated women and girls program and that sounds cool, so yeah, we're interested in that. And we gave her first grant, like £12,500, which was not a substantial sum of money. And frankly, you know, the organisation was Atuki and a few of her relatives, it wasn't much more than that. And off she went. Many years later, we have something called the Mifumi Project. And I just want to kind of reflect how she built an organisation that really demonstrated some of the great principles of systems thinking and of being a learning organisation. So she started with this savings and loans project, and after it was sort of been going for a while, she went back and talked to the women and going, how's it going? Are you earning some money? And they sort of went, well, kind of yes, but actually this is the first time I've earned my own independent income. My husband kind of goes, well, that's sort of mine because I'm the head of the household. And she's going, actually, no, it's mine because I earned it. And he's kind of going, no, it's mine and I'll beat the crap out of you if you don't give it to me. And there was a significant rise in domestic violence within the households where they had been generating some additional income. So she, having still working at this point within a women's refuge in Bristol, was like, Jesus, you know, she said, I had no idea there was this level of violence in the home within my home community. This is terrible. So she started sort of building, you know, doing some refuges, working with the police, making sure that people who perpetrated violence in the home were going to be taken to court. So she started doing all this work on domestic violence. And while she was doing it, somebody was saying, you know what, though, the real problem is bride price. And she's going, bride price? Which, if you don't know, is the practice where, you know, you get a bunch of cows and you have to give the cows to your wife's family as kind of purchase, if you will, of the wife. And she started talking to the women and they said, well, we hate bride price because we feel like chattels, we feel like we've been bought. And so then she spoke to the young guys and they said, well, we hate bride price because for us to get 5 or 10 cows together takes forever. You know, it's a real hassle. And she went, well, hang on a minute, you guys don't want it, you women don't want it, who does want it? And everybody went, no one really. So she said, okay, let's have a referendum. Let's have a referendum in this whole district of Tororo in eastern Uganda, and let's see who wants it. So she holds this referendum, the first referendum on bride price in the whole of sub-Saharan Africa. 70 to 80% of people kind of go, no, let's get rid of it. So she's kind of going, okay, well, let's do it. So they passed a bylaw in the district that you don't have to do bride price when you get married anymore. But she went, well, look, this is a practice that's common right across Uganda. So she then started knocking on the door of the Constitutional Court of Uganda saying, excuse me, can we just knock bride price out of the system? And that's kind of where she is today. She's still negotiating with the Constitutional Court. But what's interesting about this, and I think what's unusual about her and her organisation, is she sort of went down this causal link of what started off as a perfectly kind of fine bit of savings and loans into something that was really deeply embedded in the society. And she had the courage to really tackle some very, very deep-seated cultural practices which she thought were fundamentally discriminatory and cause significant levels of inequality between men and women. And I think just watching her and her organisation, they demonstrate all the attributes of kind of systems thinking and of a learning organisation. So look, I haven't even mentioned Comic Relief yet, and I work there. So I kind of thought I ought to say something about us. But the reason I focused a lot on people who we have funded is actually, in many ways, they're sort of more interesting than Comic Relief, because those are the guys at the coalface trying to create social change in their communities. But I will now talk a bit about Comic Relief, because the question then for us is, what do you do as a funder based in London to enable the likes of Atuki Turner or Mulugeta Gebru or Shahira Fawzi or whoever it might be to be as successful as they can possibly be? So this this is a kind of Mark Kramer, who does lots of writing on philanthropy. I've completely bastardized his rather more sophisticated model. But basically, he identifies three types of grant making. You've got kind of traditional grant making, which is sort of a bit like, you know, we've got a grants program, come and apply for a grant, yes to you, no to you, yes to you, no. So that's a kind of very simplistic notion of what traditional grant making is. Strategic grant making is where you tend to be focusing on a few key areas, you're looking for much more sustainable outcomes. You tend to be, as a grant maker, going out and finding the people you want to fund rather than inviting them in. And you tend to focus more on a really strong evidence base. And catalytic is very much where the philanthropy institution or the philanthropist is personally and organizationally involved in the whole change process. Now, the reason I wanted to flag this up is the world of philanthropy has been sort of turned on its head in the last 10 years as a result of a certain Mr. Bill Gates. Because he is much more, I mean, actually, they do all of this, but he's pretty much down that end. He's got so much money that if he wants to change something, he can bring a wadge of cash to it that nobody else can. And actually, he represents a new breed of primarily American, but also some European philanthropists who have come from making very significant amounts of money in the financial sector and sort of brought those business values, business approaches into philanthropy and gone, you guys have been farting around for, you know, decades trying to create change. We're going to kind of come in and sort it all out. And often they're referred to in the literature as philanthrocapitalists, is one of the kind of terms that is used for them. And so Mark Kramer's trying to kind of map this this philanthropy field. And I would hasten to add that where the philanthrocapitalists, I think, have a point, is that NGOs historically have been, it's a very fragmented field. You know, you'll find a lot of people doing their own little kind of project over here, and I'm doing my little project over there that's kind of quite similar to yours. And we do our little things, and we create these little islands of change that are probably quite unsustainable. And we have generally crap data on what kind of change that we have or haven't achieved. So to some degree, you can see the financial capitalist kind of going, Jesus, this is so inefficient. At the same time, I think many of them have got their fingers burnt because they've gone, right, we're coming in and we're going to sort it out. And then suddenly they hit this world of messy, complex problems and thought that they could just apply their business values and cut through it all. And it just hasn't happened. So I think what's been interesting is I think some of the more traditional grant makers have thought we really have to up our game in certain areas, while some of the philanthrocapitalists have gone and gone, actually, you know what, we can probably learn something from these guys who've been here for a while. And I'll come back to this little kind of matrix just to show you where I think Comic Relief is at. But I thought what I'd do now is I'd switch briefly to a few slides on Comic Relief's new grant strategy. And actually, I think the title is telling. because the title is A Flexible Strategy in a Changing World, and that's very much speaking to everything I've been talking about in terms of adaptation. Because we live in the world changes around us, and what we learn through our practice constantly makes us think differently about the world we're in. So this was a significant title for the strategy. Now, I'm not going to go into these goals, but I think if you want to be a good grant maker, generally, you need some really clear focus. Now, in a perfect world, I probably wouldn't want to have quite so many goals, but, you know, Common Relief is a broad church, and we get all our money from the public, and we need to tell many different stories to the public to kind of engage them. So that is, to some degree, why we have certain goals. But the value of having very clear goals about what you want to achieve is it provides you with some focus. It means that when you recruit people into your organisation, you recruit people who absolutely know their stuff on one of those issues. And it means they have great contacts. And it means that when you come to select organisations and when you assess grant proposals or when you manage grant proposals, you are doing it from a position of being informed. Because the people in the international grants team who I manage have achieved their personal mastery. They've clocked up their 10,000 hours. And that enables them to be very effective, I think, in the way that they make and manage grants. We have a set of principles, and they are, to some extent, our kind of uber theory of change, i.e. how do you create social change? So what you'll see, for example, building effective organisations and their leadership. So one of the things I've been talking a lot about this afternoon is about effective organisations and leadership, and that absolutely speaks to one of our core principles. We've talked about adaptation and black swans, and that's captured very clearly in one of our core principles. So these principles are very much the sort of, they're the overlay on everything that we do. So when we write a grant application form, or when we assess a grant proposal, or when we manage a grant, it's these nine principles that are the kind of golden threads, if you will, golden threads, that are woven through everything that we do, and is indeed the principles by which we measure our performance as a grant maker, i.e. do we deliver against those principles as well? Because if we're just asking our grantees to deliver and then somehow we're above it, that doesn't suggest very good practice. We have three grant making approaches, and they sort of reflect different stages of a program of work. So generating ideas is, there are a lot of organisations who are interesting organisations who've never had a grant from anybody before and don't quite know what they want, but they've got some sort of the germ of a good idea. And Comic Relief has always been key to support those organisations to get onto the first rung of the ladder. And Atuki Turner and my conversations with her is a fantastic example. Their first grant, £12,500 in mid-90s probably. Their last grant, £5 million over 5 years, and they're doing national policy change. And that's sort of illustrative of, you know, some of those small organisations will turn into, you know, colossal and influential organisations in their field. You know, not, some of them won't, I hasten to add. But we want to be there as a funder that finds those new ideas and new organisations. The implementing and adapting is the sort of meat and potatoes, I suppose, of our grant making. It's a lot of the work that we fund is under that kind of grant making model, where organisations have established, if you will, their approach, but they are then refining and improving that approach as they progress. And then achieving scale is where somebody has done really good data analysis and has proven progress and proven that their model works, and they want to take it to scale. So when we were funding the THIP project for the national rollout, that was a great example of achieving scale, although it didn't work quite as well as we wanted. Now, we've invested very heavily organisationally in monitoring, evaluation and learning. And we did a review of it the other day. One of the things that came out is that the organisations we were funding were not really doing their kind of monitoring, evaluation and learning strategy at the point of designing the project that they were going to do. And actually what came out as key is that you have to create your MEL framework at the outset. You can't wait until you've started doing things, because you'll need your baseline and you'll need to understand what indicators you're collecting at the very beginning. So we've been really pushing organisations to do that. And actually one of the things we now do is we have a two-stage grant proposal process. You do a concept note, and if you get through to stage two, we provide you with a free service of consultancy service, where you get several days of consultant support to help get your monitoring evaluation strategy sorted out, because a lot of organisations simply don't have that resource internally. And so that's a feature of our investment in organisation capacity building for monitoring, evaluation and learning. And the other thing that we found, and this goes back to the theme of adaptation, is people were kind of collecting data. Sometimes they weren't really analysing it at all. They would just have data and then sort of send it up to the funder and go, here's some data. And you'd kind of go, well, great, what are you going to do about it? And they went, oh, I just thought you wanted it. Some organisations would analyse the data and kind of go, well, that's really interesting. Well, we'll carry on anyway. And we were kind of going, well, hang on, this is telling you that that's not working and that is working, so why don't you do less of that and more of this? And they were kind of going, oh, okay, but in our logical framework, it said we were going to keep doing this for the next 5 years. And we were kind of going, no, it's a plan that can change. So this notion of timely and effective use of findings is really critical. And we created this, I think, rather lovely learning wheel, which is kind of designing, collecting, storing, analysing, applying, and sharing. And that's what we try and encourage all our grantees to do. So going back to that model I showed you earlier, so we do all these three things, right? We do traditional, strategic, and catalytic grant making. So the kind of traditional would be the kind of SETCAD project, you know, here's some money for, you know, the livelihoods for the major nomads in the southeastern desert. JECTA and Mifumi both started with these small grants doing a nice bit of project work, but both have moved into this more strategic domain. THIP was there already, Malaria Consortium was there already. So that's when you're investing in a single influential organisation to create more systemic levels of change. But there are instances where we do catalytic grant making. And I'll give you an example. In Freetown in Sierra Leone, there were massive slums. And lots of little, in that classic civil society NGO world, everybody doing, I'm over here doing my thing, and I'm over here, I'm doing my thing over here. Everybody's doing their little thing, but nobody was sort of talking to one another, nobody was sharing information, nobody was thinking about common policy positions on, you know, the rights to land or the rights to basic services or anything. So we kind of went, okay, this could be a role for comic relief. So we pulled all the organisations working in the urban slums in Freetown together and said, guys, look, you're all doing very similar work. You don't talk to one another. The city authorities are ripe for sort of influencing and trying to create a better kind of city plan. You could, if you put all your effort together, the whole could be greater than the sum of its parts. And they went, yeah, that's probably true. So we said, fine. So we basically funded, I don't know, 5 to 10 different organisations working in urban slums in Freetown. And we worked with them to say, right, let's develop a common monitoring, evaluation and learning framework. So they kind of thought, well, yeah, we can use the same indicators that some other people use, so we can compare approaches and data sets. So we've been absolutely catalytic in running a series of workshops with all those organisations and with the city authority to bring them together to take a more holistic approach to urban slum upgrading in Freetown. And we thought, I mean, that costs us more money, and that's okay, because ultimately we think if we had just funded those individual NGOs, they probably would have just carried on doing their thing. And they would have done nice stuff in that community, but it wouldn't have been a systemic change. So we will operate in all those different models of grant making. My final slide. So that the title was Beware Geeks, Bearing Griffs and Embrace the Struggle. And I just came back from South Africa at the weekend, and I went to the Hector Peterson Museum in Soweto. Hector Peterson was the guy who was shot dead during the Soweto uprisings. many years ago, and that is, it's not a great photo, but it's, I mean, well, it's a fantastic photo, it's a very poor reproduction, but it is such an iconic photo. They got massively blown up in the Hector Peterson Museum. And the reason I kind of chose that photo was, if you think about the anti-apartheid struggle, you had the ANC, they were kind of using violence, and then they sort of weren't using violence, and then all their leaderships were on Robben Island, and then you had the youth movements in places like Soweto taking up a different type of struggle, and then you had Steve Biko and the Black Consciousness Movement doing their thing, and then you had the disinvestments campaign in Europe and North America and the anti-apartheid movement. You had all these different...
The struggle shapes the solutions to the context. People take time to learn, back to our 10,000 hours. An analogy, Roger Federer comes and says to me, Richard, look, come on, I'll show you how to serve. You go like that, and then you go, whoop. And I'm not going to be able to serve like Roger Federer after an hour or two. I'm not going to probably serve like Roger Federer after 10,000 hours. But the point is that the learning process is in itself, you acquire new knowledge, you acquire new understanding, it's part of the struggle. And there just aren't shortcuts. The third thing about embracing the struggle is the struggle confers legitimacy. So to give you an example, you could have brought in a lawyer and say, can you just write an agreement between, you know, the Republicans and the Unionists in Northern Ireland? Well, yeah. What's not really going to cut it, is it? You're not going to get the unions to write, yeah, fine, that looks, well, that works for us. You know, the fact that those guys were in struggle and then negotiating the agreement gave the agreement legitimacy and gives it strength, and that's why it has lasted and will hopefully last for the foreseeable future. So there is that nature of being part of that struggle, being part of that, of giving you legitimacy to act and to speak. And finally, systems co-evolve. So the analogy for that I wanted to use was, if you go back to the days of Thabo Mbeki in South Africa, and the time, he was, you know, that kind of AIDS denial going on, and at the time the big farmer was sort of saying, well, no, we have to sell like our bees $80 a month to somebody living with HIV. And the treatment action campaign was there kind of going, this is just wrong, you know, this is morally wrong. And they were very effective as a movement of people living and affected by HIV, campaigning against big pharma, campaigning against the South African government. Now, the point at which we went down, the point that there was a massive change in the attitudes of the South African government, and the point at which drugs became affordable, because you could buy generic drugs from India or wherever it might be, the system changed. And treatment action were like, oh, we've kind of done it, but there's still huge needs for people living and affected by HIV, so the treatment action campaign had to evolve as that environment changed. And actually, one of the things that we've been funding at the moment is a major change program for the Treatment Action Campaign to redefine their role in this new environment in South Africa. So the reason I kind of wanted to capture this, and this was taken from some work by Pritchard and Walcott just this year, was because I think if you're in the business of trying to create social change, it's a struggle. And don't be afraid of the struggle, just feel a part of it. And I know sometimes it can, you just kind of, oh, Jesus Christ, walk away from this, it's too hard. But that's the nature of struggle. And I think what it means for leaders is, I mean, any leader that you find will inevitably have vision. It's sort of inherent in leadership. They will invariably be dogged in what they do because they want to achieve something. What they're not always good at, I don't think, is the bit of adaptation. Being that kind of reflective practitioner where you're constantly taking on new information and new learning And I think for me, those are the three most critical features, you know, speaking to this whole issue of leadership and international development, being able to show those three attributes, if you will, I think is what really contributes to an effective leader. So, thank you very much.